Almost. There's Johnny, as they say. Hey, everybody, and welcome to Chef AJ Live. I'm your host, Chef AJ, and this is where I introduce you to amazing people like you who are doing great things in the world that I think you should know about. Back by popular demand, we have Dr. John McDougall, who is going to be giving the second part of his brand new lecture on protein. If you missed part one, I will link to it below in the show notes so you can watch it. Please welcome back Dr. John McDougall. How are you doing?
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be back.
Well, we love having you, Dr. McDougall.
Well, good. I've had my time kind of split this past week between a couple of projects. One is, of course, getting this protein lecture done, because we have to have the truth about protein out there. We'll never make substantial dietary changes for individuals and for the planet. I mean, you got to have the truth. Right now, the first thing that you're going to be asked when you tell somebody you're a vegetarian or a vegan is, where do you get your protein? Well, that should be the last question ever asked, because protein deficiency is unheard of, which is what I talked about in the last set of lectures. I went to the last set of lectures and told you a little bit about the microbiologic structure of proteins. I discussed the use of proteins. I also discussed the how recommendations on proteins came about and how it was mostly due to bigotry. In other words, researchers at that time thought that rich people were the only people smart enough to make the right choices in terms of food. And less educated people, such as those who work around the equatorial zones of the world, who work as laborers in the field, who do not eat all that meat, et cetera, they must be really stupid. And so they must have the wrong recommendations on protein needs. And I went through some of the arguments that I've had about protein needs and trying to get respected organizations like the American Heart Association and various universities to correct the misinformation. I have to say that, you know, I've worked for the last 20 years to try and get them to look at the correct information, but they refuse to. I don't know why. Maybe it's an ego thing. Maybe it's we had it right in the first place and you're not going to change my mind. Anyways, I pointed out to you that that when people starve to death, as they did among the Irish, who with the IRA starved to death over a picture period of 60 days, they didn't die of protein deficiency. They died of fat deficiency. So people should be asking, where do you get your fat? Anyway, you can go through that whole discussion about protein and our protein needs and how we came about our protein recommendations, why it is absolutely ridiculous to consider protein an important nutrient, unless you get into, you know, fake foods, you can get into trouble. Of course, you eat just pure sugar, et cetera. But on any natural diet, it's impossible to design a diet that's protein deficient. Anyway, that's been part of my effort, is to finish the discussion of protein, which I'm going to do in the next few minutes. But the other half of my week has been spent getting ready for tomorrow's event, which is the 9th of January, 2021. We're going to do a world-changing event. You're concerned about climate change, no doubt about it. You're looking to all efforts that you could take to save this planet. Everybody seems to be, so to speak, in their own way, trying to save the planet by buying more efficient cars, et cetera. But I want to point out that nobody is talking in any seriousness, at least nobody of any power, is talking of any seriousness about the effect of the global diet on the health of our planet. And the truth of the matter is over half the greenhouse gases are produced by the livestock industry, and that if we change our diet to a vegan diet, the diet that all of us follow, the healthiest diet in the world, that will cut global warming gas emissions down somewhere between 50 and 80%, far greater than you can ever do with harnessing fossil fuels. In fact, the statement has been made by many experts. Even if we got all the fossil fuel issues under control, we stopped using fossil fuel completely because of the sad state of our planet, we would not be around. Species would become extinct. But these same experts, they tell us that if we take account of our diet, we can't save this place. So what I have decided to do, and it's been mostly out of the fact that nobody else has taken the role, is I've decided to be the stalwart, the the point person when it comes to diet and changing the planet. I'm just going to feverishly talk to people about the importance of changing the diet to save the planet. Why? Because, you know, I care. Even though I'm in my mid-70s, I really do care what happens to this planet Earth. I may not see the end, but I know it's coming. So this event tomorrow, which is an all-day event, will have many world experts on in terms of agriculture and the effect on the planet and what to do about it. We're going to talk about some very hopeful things. We put out the enrollment for this program a couple of days ago, and we had 500 spots. They filled up in 45 minutes. But you can watch it, I believe, on Facebook Live. So if you'd like to watch it tomorrow on Facebook Live or some other type of live streaming media, it may be on there. For the next event, we're going to have one, I believe, January 30th, 2021. We will open the enrollment to at least 500 people, maybe more. But regardless, we want to have as many people as possible hear this message and to take it serious. My good grief, Al Gore in 2006, he did The Inconvenient Truth, which told us we were in huge trouble, but he didn't mention the food in his sequel of Inconvenient Truth in 2017. Guess what? He forgot to mention food. Well, Greta Thunberg, who is the young woman who has taken upon herself to become the leader in the world in encouraging dietary change, she recommends a vegan diet, but not with a lot of enthusiasm. And nobody is willing to stand up to the importance of changing the diet to save the planet, because if we don't, we won't. And so from now on, you can start thinking about the McDougall program as a program focused on diet and climate change. Yeah, we'll still be doing our job, taking care of patients. We still run our 12-day internet program where we'll get you off your drugs and out of trouble. In fact, the one we have scheduled for next week sold out. You know, I'm happy it's sold out. We'll figure out some way to make it more available to more people. But if you want to get signed up for February, April, May, now's the time to sign up. And we'll help you. We'll do your medical care. We'll do your education. And we will end up making you one of the soldiers in this movement to save the planet. It's all I really care about. I spent 40 years healing patients' problems like diabetes and heart disease and obesity and so on. And not that it's getting old, because I really enjoy that. Like, I got a letter from a lady today, really did, email today, said 7 years ago, I listened to you about my breast cancer. I didn't have my lymph nodes removed. I'm so glad. I didn't have any radical surgery. I'm so glad. I didn't go for chemotherapy. Oh, I look back from 7 years enjoying excellent health. And I really appreciate what you and Mary did for you. I wrote her back and I said, you made my day. You know, it's nice to change people's lives in over a period of 12 days. We do always. We have an extremely effective McDougall team. And we know what we're doing. Not only do we know what we're doing in terms of your individual health, but we know what needs to be done in terms of the planet. You just can't switch to skim milk and skin chicken, folks. The situation is too dire. Anyway, I would like you to join me in any way that you can, telling the truth. You know, after this lecture today, you can tell the truth about protein. Never, never allow anybody to walk up to you and say, where do you get your protein, without giving them an educated answer. So well delivered that they'll never make that mistake again. But you can always show them these lectures. They're free and available. In fact, I want to thank AJ for giving me the opportunity to practice my new material. And you folks for bearing with my imperfections when I do the best I can at telling you the story about protein. Anyway, thank you, AJ, for giving me a platform to discuss with people the importance of a good diet and how we're able to heal most chronic diseases with a simple dietary change. And of course, that's a diet based on starch, like rice, corn, potatoes, with the addition of green and yellow vegetables. The McDougall diet is very simple. Starch-based diet with fruits and vegetables. The second sentence is it contains no animal products and no free oils, like olive oil, corn oil, et cetera. So simple. And we're going to unleash what we have learned over the last 40 years upon the planet with your help. And I hope you get a chance to tune in tomorrow, because you'll meet five other experts I have a chance to talk to. So there'll be three experts on the issues of agriculture, diet, and planetary survival. So let's go into the presentation here. And let's see what we got. Okay. So part two of Dr. McDougall Slay's King Protein. Well, people believe today that protein is associated with vitality, strength, power, vigor, maleness, aggressiveness, liveliness. Oh, I mean, it is the most important nutrient out there. That's what people tell you. But the truth of the matter is just the opposite. You add more protein, you become weaker, sicker, less productive, dysfunctional, damages your entire system. This is a toxin when provided in excess. Yeah, we need some, a little bit. But are you taking too much? You overburden the system. All right, so protein, first of all, let's go through some of the dietary myths. The idea that more protein associated with strength and endurance, that should be easily discarded as a truth by understanding that the strongest, most enduring people in the world live on a low-protein diet. For example, studies of the skeletons of men who lived 1,800 years ago in what is now Turkey, the country of Turkey, who fought battles. When they examined their skeletons that were killed with swords and tridents, and they found swords and tridents and shields in their grave plots, and they analyzed these mighty warriors, and they found that their diet was primarily barley. In fact, they were known as the barley men. So if you want to emulate somebody with great strength and you want to emulate their diet, how about picking a diet like these mighty warriors followed, a diet of barley with a few greens? And today, the modern warriors, the most respected athletes when it comes to endurance, eat a starch-based diet. They eat a low-protein diet. They eat a diet based on corn, which is 8% of the calories is protein. Barley was only 12% protein. The typical American diet, as you're going to learn, is higher than that in protein. And so we find, for example, the Kenyan men between 1987 and 2016, they won 40% of the longer events in terms of triathlons, marathons, etc., on diets like you and I follow. One thing I want to establish as we move on to this lecture is that all animal foods are the same. Meat, cheese, fish, any kind of meat. These things are sold to the public based upon bits of information that are unique to these particular products through a marketing technique called unique positioning. What they do is they tell you about something important about their particular product. For example, when we talk about meat, we talk about protein. And if somebody asks you where you get your calcium, you respond by dairy. And how about omega-3 fats? Well, from fish. As you well know, as we've discussed, is there's no such thing as protein deficiency. There's no such thing as calcium deficiency. And all the omega-3s that ever ended up in fish or cows or pigs came from algae and seaweeds and other plants, because only plants can desaturate at the carbon-3 position and make omega-3 fats. If you take a look at various kinds of muscles, you should see the similarity. The common dictum is that the way to get healthy is to switch from cow legs to chicken wings, to fish fins. Well, switching from muscle to muscle to muscle is basically no change at all. I mean, compare that with making a switch to broccoli or apples or potatoes. There's a drastic difference. If you want to be different, then you'll eat differently. And switching between various kinds of muscles is going to make no difference at all. And in fact, years of scientific research studying patients show that when people switch from beef and pork to chicken and fish, their cholesterols never go down. And they often go up. Same thing with dairy. You can put dairy in the same kind of category as similar foods, animal products. Dairy can be think of as basically liquid meat. Compare ground beef, cheddar cheese. And what you find is they're both similar in the number of calories. About 70% of the calories are fat. About 30% of the calories are protein. Virtually no carbohydrate, no fiber, loaded with cholesterol. It's liquid meat. So again, don't fool yourself by just becoming a vegetarian, because you're switching from animal foods to animal foods. Some of them happen to be muscles on their body. Others are secretions that they intended for their young. So people who buy into the American diet are sick. This is universal. I mean, consider the fact that following the American diet gives statistics such as these for the people who live in the United States, Europe, and now more so in Asia and India. 1/3 have elevated cholesterol, 1/3 have hypertension, more than 30% are obese, and 65% are overweight, and 10% are diabetic, and half of the populations in China, the United States, Europe, are pre-diabetic. Half of the people who follow the Western diet die prematurely of heart disease. Half develop life-threatening cancers. That's of men. 1/3 of women develop life-threatening cancers. Over the age of 60, 30% of people have gallbladder disease. 1 in 7 suffers from serious arthritis. 60% of them complain of bad breath, and most have gastrointestinal disturbances. How in the world can anybody come to the conclusion that ideal nutrition is the basic four food charts? Comes from the basic four food charts. It's a prescription for sickness. The way that protein meat acts as a poison, it is a poison. I don't give you this word just for its emotional reaction. I mean, consider the definition of a poison as a substance that is capable of causing the illness or death of a living organism when consumed. The last two slides, I just showed you what happens to people who consume a diet that is more than sufficient in protein. By many means, this kind of diet based on livestock hurts people. It is high calorie, which leads to obesity, diabetes, heart disease, promotes cancer. It's high fat, which promotes heart disease and cancer. High in saturated fat, which rots your arteries. High in protein, which damages the bones and gives you kidney stones. High in cholesterol, which helps rot your arteries. And low in dietary fiber, which makes you constipated, gives you hemorrhoids. Vitamin deficient, vitamin imbalanced, and loaded with environmental contaminants. And I'd like to spend some time going into some of these points in detail. I want to divide them into basic categories of dietary poisons, 5 dietary poisons. And they are protein. And if you compare the kind of diet that I recommend, and hopefully you follow, which is a starch-based diet, to the typical American diet, you can see the exaggerated amount of toxins that people are consuming when they follow the Western diet. Take a look at the protein. It's 3 times more protein consumed by Americans as us. Fat intake is 15 times greater. Cholesterol intake is infinitesimally greater because we eat no cholesterol. Methionine, which is one of the sulfur-containing amino acids we were going to talk about, there's 4 times as much methionine in the rich Western diet as in the kind of diet we follow. And the acid produced as a consequence of eating these rich animal foods is at least 10 times as great on the Western diet. Let's talk about the protein content. You'll notice that whether it's chickens or ducks or beefs or cows or whatever, all the protein content, the percent of calories as protein is about 40 to 50%. If you take a look at the diet that we consume, it's as little as 6%, which is sweet potatoes, and as high as 28%, which are some of your beans. In between is a protein content of the food that we need and can tolerate. People believe, I have to assume that the logic that goes to eating all of this animal food, particularly among bodybuilders, weightlifters, is people believe that the way to be strong is to eat muscle. And somehow, if you eat muscle, it turns into muscle. I would challenge you with the fact that if eating muscle turned to muscle, all of us would look like Arnold Schwarzenegger used to look like. It really doesn't happen. Eating muscle doesn't turn to muscle. It would be about as silly as eating hair to cure baldness. or eating bones to avoid fractures, or eating brains to raise your IQ, or what would you eat to improve your sexual abilities? Got your attention there, AJ. Well, it doesn't work, folks. But what you eat in terms of fat is added to your body. The fat you eat is the fat you wear. So what happens to the excess protein we eat? It doesn't turn to muscle. The body has no place to store it. If it stored it, it would store it in the muscles. Protein is not stored, and you only need a tiny amount. Maybe 3% of your calories have to be protein, that's all. And on the kind of diet we recommend, 8, 10, 12% of the calories are protein. What happens when you eat a diet that's 40, 50, 60% protein, or even worse, you're on one of these low-carb diets? Well, that extra protein has to be gotten rid of. It's processed by the liver, and the metabolites that are produced are sent to the kidneys, where it overworks the kidneys. And as a consequence, what happens is that protein is eliminated from the kidneys via the liver. And it burdens both of these organs. If you eat a high protein diet and you've got to do all this extra work to get rid of the extra protein, what happens is you wear the liver out and you wear the kidneys out. People who have damaged kidneys already, whether or not they end up on a dialysis machine, depends upon whether they were taught and they follow a low protein diet. We've known for 100 years that the fundamental therapy for people with failing kidneys is a low protein diet. So when you eat this extra protein, you cause a change in the metabolism in the kidneys, which results in the excretion of large amounts of calcium through the kidney system into the urinary tract, into the bladder. That calcium and bone material that is excreted as a consequence of the forces trying to eliminate the extra protein solidifies often into kidney stones. In the process of metabolizing that extra protein, the body breaks down the protein, and because the proteins are made of amino acids, breaks down the products into various acidic products, which actually destroy the bones. They destroy them because the bones are required to buffer the acid from the food. It's not just the protein that causes the kidneys to overwork and excrete the calcium. It's also the acid that's produced. We measure this in something called renal acid load. What we find is that the high-protein animal foods that we eat are very high in acids. It's basically from the fact that they're made of amino acids. Plus, one of the most prevalent amino acids in animal products are sulfur-containing amino acids, cysteine and methionine. And they break down into sulfuric acid. As a result of all this acid produced from eating all the animal foods, the body has to buffer the acid because the pH must be guarded. The acid-base balance of the body must be guarded very carefully, or you die. So to neutralize this acid that you take in by eating all the animal foods, the body dissolves the bones and releases alkaline material. And this is the first step towards developing osteoporosis. Acidification of the blood. The body's pH is maintained at 7.4. As I mentioned, if you don't maintain that pH 7.4, you die. So if you eat acid and you tend your pH towards a lower number, you die. Well, the body doesn't want to die, so it protects itself mainly by releasing alkaline material from the bones to neutralize the acids. This is seen in incidences of osteoporosis around the world. We find in various populations of people that the more animal protein they eat, which is also the more acid they eat, the more hip fractures they suffer from. South African blacks. There was a time back in the 1980s, I used to read the scientific literature about the women who lived in Africa, and they couldn't find a single hip fracture in rural African women. You say rural African women don't live long enough to get hip fractures. Well, at that time I was studying this, 10% of the population was over the age of 60. Papua New Guinea, virtually no hip fractures. They eat a diet, or ate a diet. This has all changed, folks, over the last 30 years. They ate a diet where 92% of the calories came from sweet potatoes, which are only 6% protein. as you increase the daily protein intake worldwide, go country by country, you increase the hip fracture risk. And this is just the opposite of what happens when you increase the calcium intake worldwide. As you increase calcium intake, you get the same type of increase in hip fractures. You would expect otherwise. You would expect the calcium will protect the bones. It doesn't. And the very products that you consume actually may contribute to the deterioration of the bones. Again, country by country, the lowest calcium intakes have the strongest bones. And as you increase the calcium intake from dairy products and calcium supplements, you see an increase in populations that have high rates of hip fracture. One of the highest protein diets ever consumed in modern history is the diet consumed by the Inuits. The Inuits have some interesting health characteristics from their high protein diet. They live in a diet of various mammals like whales and seals and lots of fish. In fact, for about 10 months of the year, they follow the Atkins diet. And as a result, they consume a diet that's about 35% protein. Compared to the American diet, which is 20% protein, compared to the diet that you and I eat, which is 12% protein, compared to the Kempner diet, which is one of the most healing diets I know of, which is only 5% protein. Again, you need only 3% of your diet as protein calories for good health. But it's impossible to eat a diet let alone in protein. Studies of the Inuit Eskimo find some very telling things. For example, when they studied Inuit Eskimo women and men in the early 1970s, they had osteoporosis rates, bone mineral density test scores, 10% worse than the average American in every decade of life. And this wasn't just the modern Inuit Eskimo woman. In a study of remains of two Eskimo women that were buried 500 years ago in an ice floe, their bodies were almost perfectly preserved, and certainly the bone structure was preserved. What they did is they examined these women, and they found notably that they had no atherosclerosis. They suffered from atherosclerosis, but they didn't suffer from any clinical disease, heart disease, strokes. It was very rare. But their arteries were rotten. And what they also found in these two women is they had extensive atherosclerosis. So this isn't just a consequence of the modern diet. It's been going back for centuries, wherever people ate an animal food-based diet. Now, the McDougall diet has some alkaline foods. Let me see if I can go back there for you. No. The McDougall diet is primarily made of alkaline foods, but some of our foods are slightly acidic. For example, your grains and your legumes have an acid load value of approximately 1. Whereas cheese is the most acidic of all things, have an acid load value of 10. Other vegetable foods are quite alkaline. For example, potatoes are -5. Tomatoes are -35. Spinach is -56, meaning they are very alkaline. So you'll have people argue with you as a vegetarian or a vegan. They'll argue with you and they'll say, look, you can't be eating all these grains and legumes because they're acidic and they'll cause bone damage. Acidic compared to what? Grains and legumes have an acid load value of 1. Fish is 9. Beef is 7. Cheese is 10. Compared to what? I mean, the body can neutralize acid loads of +1. No trouble at all. We see this because of the fact that Asian populations who live on primarily rice-based diets have almost no osteoporosis. So the body has an ability to absorb and neutralize some of the acid, but not acid loads such as cheese and meat and fish, etc. Now, if you make the McDougall diet, which is the kind of diet that most of you follow, at least to some extent, and you make, for example, minestrone soup with spinach, which is very alkaline at an acid load of -56, tomatoes with an acid load of -35, potatoes with an acid load of -5, you make a soup that includes some beans and grains with an acid load of plus one, and you mix it all together, what do you end up with? You end up with an alkaline diet. The McDougall diet, and the kind of diet that you are supposed to follow and probably do, is an alkaline diet. So the bones don't have to dissolve to neutralize the acid, which ends up producing bone material in the kidneys, in other words, kidney stones. Now, when we talk about protein, I want to make one clarification, and that is there's a difference between animal and vegetable protein. Animal protein is associated, comes from animal products, which have a whole bunch of other nasty things with them, like cholesterol and fat and environmental contaminants and lack of fiber and imbalance of vitamins and minerals. So you're eating unhealthy food that has many types of unhealthy components when you get your protein from animal foods. Animal protein, if you compare the same grams of protein consumed by a person, animal proteins raise cholesterol and blood sugar higher than do the same amount of vegetable protein. There are different changes in the gut microbiome, the gut flora, depending on whether or not you eat animal or vegetable sources of protein. And of course, you have the problem of very high acid amino acids providing sulfur-containing amino acids from animal foods. And you have the problem of overworking the kidneys and liver. And studies found, early studies, ones that will never be repeated, but studies found and treatments prescribed back when I was a young doctor, the fundamental therapy for somebody who was suffering from liver failure or kidney failure was a very low protein diet. And particular with an emphasis on vegetable proteins. It's found, for example, that if you take people with failing livers who are in hepatic coma, they're asleep, and you switch the source of protein from animal protein to vegetable protein, they'll wake up. That's the difference in burden of animal and vegetable protein. So even though I'm talking about protein in general, I must make the clarification that animal proteins, because of their association and because of their natural characteristics, are much more toxic to the body than plant proteins. But you can't leave them off all blame, because when people use vegetable protein as a source, particularly concentrated vegetable proteins like wheat protein in the form of gluten or soy protein, they end up going into negative calcium balance, losing a tremendous amount of calcium from their body into the urine. In a study done by one of our past guests at the Advanced Study Weekends, Dr. David Jenkins from University of Toronto, he did this particular study where he took vegetarians, vegans, and fed them a diet high in wheat protein and measured their calcium balances. And what he found was the high protein diet, which was made of gluten, which created a bread that was 50% protein. Compared to that with control bread, which was very low in protein, they found that they increased their calcium losses to a significant amount. Yeah. And when they tested soy proteins, like isolated soy protein, a similar thing was found. If you look at the graph over here on the right-hand side, you'll see that on a high-protein diet, when it came to meat protein, it made much more impact on urinary calcium than when it came to soy protein. But soy protein still caused an excessive amount of excretion of calcium through your body, in other words, loss of bone material. And I want to point out to you, you actually don't see only calcium in the urine. You also see different types of proteins that are unique to the bones, which end up being dissolved, floating through the bloodstream and to the kidneys, and are excreted into the urine. So this is actual loss of bone that occurs, not just calcium being leaked from the bones. This is bone destruction. My caution to you is that you should be very careful. Pay attention, minimize these concentrated vegetable source of proteins, particularly gluten and soy proteins. Let's talk about fat for a minute. One of the dietary poisons. Animal foods contain 15 times more fat than does our diet. Fat contents that may be in, quote, low-fat poultry, that are about 50% of the calories is protein. Same thing with fish. Maybe 50% of the calories can be fat from fish. I meant to say fat. About half the calories from red meats and white meats come from fat. And so does the calories from fish comes from fat. Compared to the fat intake in our diet, where the percent of calories that are fat are around 1, 2, 3, 4, 5%. At least 15 times greater fat intake on the American diet. In this case, the fat you eat is the fat you wear. I found this interesting. The half-life of a fat, if you stopped eating fat altogether, 600 days later, half the fat would remain. Whatever kind of fat you eat ends up on your body fat. It goes from your lips to your hips. And we know this because in scientific research, if you take and biopsy the body fat of individuals, you find that their body fat reflects their dietary fat. In other words, if you eat a high fish diet, you're going to have loads of omega-3 fats found on biopsy of your fatty tissues. If you eat a diet high in margarines or Criscos, you're going to be full of trans fats. You eat a diet high in olive oil, you'll be full of monounsaturated fats. The fat you eat is the fat you wear. Here's a study that they did back in 1960, where they fed people diets high in corn oil, and they found that the corn oil replaced their body fat over a matter of time. People will say that fat has nothing to do with whether or not you're fat. Well, I ask them, please read the scientific literature. I put here forth for you some of the major studies done showing that the fat you eat is the fat you wear. Percentage of fatty acids were significantly correlated with the percent of total fat intake for polyunsaturated fatty acid diets. When they biopsied their body fat, they found a reflection of their dietary fat. And here are six major studies that show that. The fat you eat is the fat you wear. So logic says the amount of fat in your diet is crucial. Let's take a look at cholesterol content. The cholesterol content of the rich Western diet compared to what we eat has 100 times more cholesterol. And this is reflected most importantly in diets that are high cholesterol, low carbohydrate, high protein diets, as recommended by Atkins and his ancillary experts. There have been 7 major studies published over the last 6 years that show that people who are on these low carb, high protein diets have a dramatic increased risk of dying of heart disease and strokes. There's no contrary information. There's no information that says if you eat a diet high in carbohydrate, low in protein, low in fat like we eat, causes an increase in mortality or heart disease. It just isn't there. Yeah, people continue to argue that their point of view is correct based on what? Certainly not the science. And this cholesterol, along with the other damaging components of the rich Western diet, end up rotting the arteries. And this is not just the arteries in your heart, folks, or maybe you've concluded the arteries in your brain leading to strokes are ones involved, but the only ones involved. But this is reflected in 44,000 miles of circulation. And whatever organ is compromised, you end up having what you think is this distinct, unique disease. But these are all from the same cause. They're all tied together by the circulatory system. If you decrease the blood flow to the eyes, then you get macular degeneration. The macula is the most acute seen part of the eye. You decrease the hearing to the ear. There's only one tiny artery that goes to your inner ear. And you clog it up with the products of atherosclerosis. You go deaf. You get ringing in the ears. You lose your balance. Major strokes are a consequence of closing the arteries to the brain, heart attacks to the heart, aneurysms, closing the arteries to other big basic arteries. Kidney failure is primarily due to artery disease, ball infarction. Back pain is due to low blood supply to the heart in many cases. and people who have ruptured discs due to degenerative disc disease. It's poor circulation that allows the disc to become so weak that they'll rupture under the slightest movement, such as turning. You didn't lift a Volkswagen to fracture your discs. You close the arteries to the legs. You get pain when you walk. You close them down very badly. You get gangrene. And this is one that'll probably get your attention. I certainly know it will get AJ's attention. You close the arteries to the penis. You become impotent. All right. So let's talk about one of the sulfur-containing amino acids. And we could also carry on this discussion with the other sulfur-containing amino acids, which is cysteine. As we talked about in the first lecture, there are 20 amino acids that build all the proteins in nature. There are 10 of them that we can make. Excuse me, there are 12 of them we can make. And there are 8 we can't. Those are essential amino acids. And 2 of the amino acids are sulfur-containing amino acids. They're methionine and cysteine. And you could see the methionine content of various foods. Eggs, chicken, pork, fish, beef, etc. all have a very high methionine contents. Fish in particular, compared to what we eat. 4 times as much methionine the average American eats compared to what we eat. Damage from all this methionine, as we talked about, results in osteoporosis and kidney stones. It's known to be toxic to the intestine, which causes inflammatory bowel disease and osteocolitis. It's involved in the mechanism. There are many, many other things involved. But the sulfur, which is a consequence of eating sulfur, is a major factor in contributing to these bowel diseases. We know sulfur restriction in experimental animals, for example. I know a lot of you don't like to talk about animal experimentation, and I understand. Sulfur restriction consistently causes animals to live longer. Sulfur leads to the smell of rotten eggs. So it leads to body odor, bad breath, and stinky farts. Sulfur feeds cancer. If you take and design an experimental setting where you grow cancer cells and you eliminate sulfur-containing compounds from the mixture, the cancer cells won't grow. And sulfur contributes to the development of atherosclerosis via a mechanism that results in the degradation of methionine into homocysteine, leading to heart attack, strokes, etc. Oh, I want to mention one other thing here. And that is that when I talk about the sulfur content of foods, you have to realize that what I'm talking about is digested food. When the proteins are intact, say in the beef or pork or chicken or cheese, then these amino acids are not acidic. They're in long chains and their hydrogen components are pretty much hidden. It's only after the digestion of these proteins into amino acids that they have the strong acidic effect. Now, people will come back to me and they'll say, well, you know, you have it all wrong, McDougall. Citrus fruits, lemons, limes, oranges, they're all full of citric acid. They're very acidic foods. No, they're not. I mean, they're acidic if you take a pH meter and you measure the juice. But when you take and digest the whole orange or the whole tangerine, you end up with an alkaline food mixture. So don't be confused by a well-meaning dietitian who says, oh, no, no. It's not animal foods that provide all the acid. It's fruits. It's citrus fruits. It's obvious. It's surface acid. That's all. It's surface acid. And overall, the total component of an orange or lemon is an alkaline intake, which is good for your bones and prevents kidney stones. Well, let's talk about the effect of high protein on growth stimulation. What we found is that when you consume a high protein diet, in particular a diet high in soy proteins, that you increase the amount, in fact, any high protein diet will increase the amount of a cancer promoting substance called insulin-like growth factor 1. It's a protein. It looks like insulin, but its primary function is stimulating growth. And so soy protein, milk, meat, etc., they cause an increase in this IGF-1, insulin growth factor 1. But you must realize that one of the strongest promoters of the production of insulin growth factor 1 is soy, isolated soy protein in particular. And that type of growth stimulation is very unfavorable when it comes to cancer. But also, anything that increases the amount of growth hormone in your body increases your size and decreases your longevity. Many of you who are dog owners, and I know AJ's a dog owner, many of you are dog owners, you have to prefer little dogs for various reasons. But one of the reasons may be that little dogs will be with you longer. Little dogs live 14 years on average, sometimes 17. Big dogs, I always like big dogs, AJ. Big dogs, they have a short lifespan. My Rottweilers live to be 8, 9, 10 years old at best. And when you measure the IGF-1 levels in their bodies, you find that small dogs have low levels of IGF-1 and big dogs have high levels of IGF-1. And so the same thing we find in people. Bigger people die sooner. And I'm not talking about being fat. You know, I'm not talking about increasing your girth. I'm talking about your height. Taller people die faster. And the mechanism for this may be due to the IGF-1 levels. And let's hope so, because we found that by switching to a vegan diet, you lower your IGF-1 stimulation levels in men and women. Let's talk about autoimmune diseases for a minute. The protein is the antigen that initiates autoimmune diseases where the body attacks itself. I mean, I heard this for years. It upset me so much. Why would the body attack itself? It makes no sense at all. The body attacks itself when you're told you have an autoimmune disease like rheumatoid arthritis, lupus. How unkind for the body to do that. Well, it does it because we feed ourselves improperly and it results in mechanisms where the body can't function as it should. When you have a protein enter the body that's foreign, like, for example, a bacteria or a virus, what happens is the body makes antibodies from lymphocytes, makes antibodies that directly attack these proteins, say, in this case, on a viral coat, and sets them up to be destroyed. Now, these antibodies are very specific to the proteins that are present on the virus, and this is why flu vaccines don't work, is because the flu is different than the vaccine that they make. The flu vaccine is based upon viruses that have come through last year or 5 years ago or 3 years ago, not the virus that's going to come through today. And so we don't have the specific information designed to attack with our lymphocytes the viruses that are current. Now, it seems that the new COVID vaccine is going to work well. But you hear on the news the concerns about variants that are popping up. The concern is that the COVID vaccine will become ineffective because this is a new viral strain. And it may so happen. As most of you know, I'm in favor of the COVID vaccine, and Mary and I will be first in line to take it. The reason is it's been too long since I've held my grandchildren. I'm willing to take the risk. Well, when other proteins, for example, dietary proteins, enter the body, sometimes they don't get completely digested in the gut, and instead they end up intact in the bloodstream. And so now you have a foreign protein floating around the bloodstream, for example, beef or pork. And the body makes antibodies to the beef or pork. Unfortunately, these antibodies aren't just specific to proteins found in beef and pork, because these are animals. Cows and pigs are animals, and we're animals. Our proteins are similar to the cow and pig protein, but they're different. They're not totally similar, they're different. And so because of their similarity, the body makes antibodies to the cow or the pig, which cross-react and attack our own tissues. It's called molecular mimicry. In other words, a copy of what's found on the food protein, the beef or pork, is found on our own tissues. And so in the process of trying to destroy the beef and pork, the body attacks your joints or your brain, all kinds of parts of the body. And so it is with milk protein. Milk is particularly guilty when it comes to providing proteins that the body reacts to in a negative way. And it's one of the most concerning foods, dairy products, when it comes to the cause and the cure of various autoimmune diseases. One of the most notable autoimmune diseases that has been studied thoroughly is type 1 diabetes. Back in the early 90s, researchers studied and published in the New England Journal of Medicine their findings on type 1 diabetes. What they discovered was there were 17 amino acids present on the beta casein proteins segment of dairy proteins, 17 amino acids, they identified them. And these 17 amino acids were present in a similar structure on the surface of the insulin producing cells of the pancreas. So you consume the milk protein gets into the bloodstream, not supposed to be there. It's foreign, it could be a virus or a bacteria. And so the body makes antibodies against this foreign substance. But because there are similar protein sequences in various tissues in the body, in the process of looking for these bad guys, it ends up attacking your own tissues. Same thing with rheumatoid arthritis, lupus. The body finds sequences of protein in the cartilage surfaces that are the same as cow's milk protein. And so what we find, and many of you discovered, is that you cure these autoimmune diseases by getting rid of the animal foods. All kinds of problems that you may have thought were unconnected. Just like when we talked about the circulation, you may have found no connection between impotence and hearing loss, or gangrene, or strokes. They're all tied together by this 44,000 miles of circulation. So it is with various autoimmune diseases that you never connected together. They're all tied to an immune system that's trying to function normally. But because of the foods we eat and the consequences of consuming this unhealthy diet, this immune system turns against ourselves. And we get problems such as hair loss, ankylosing spondylitis, Crohn's disease, dermatomyositis. You can read all of these. I don't have time to go through all of them. But you have friends and relatives with these problems. They're all interconnected. Same mechanism. And fortunately, the same cure. But I have to add here that often when people come to this realization, they've already destroyed their entire thyroid, so they're hypothyroid. Or they've already destroyed their entire pancreas, so they have type 1 diabetes for life. You want to make this kind of discovery early in life before you get sick. But even after you're in trouble, you need to change your diet and you will get benefits. It'll stop the inflammatory component of the disease. You'll be left with residual, such as scar tissue. But you won't have any more attacks. And we find that almost all patients with inflammatory arthritis, like rheumatoid, lupus, ankylosing spondylitis, and psoriatic arthritis, within a matter of 4 to 7 days, they start to feel better. And most of them are cured within 4 months. Doesn't mean that their crooked joints are going to straighten out. Of course not. But they stop having the acute illness and they can get on with their lives, and they're generally pain-free afterwards. So part of this process of developing the autoimmune diseases involves damage in the gut, because the gut, in this case, the gut will not maintain its integrity. And as a result, it lets proteins intact from the gut into the bloodstream. And they're present in the bloodstream, they're not supposed to be there. So what causes damage to the gut lining that makes it non-functional? Well, I think this problem affects a large number of people, but most specifically and most dramatically, you see this in the case of celiac disease. It's well known that people with celiac disease have a very high rate of thyroiditis, an autoimmune disease, rheumatoid arthritis, an autoimmune disease, multiple sclerosis, an exorbitant risk of that, getting that disease. Why? Because when you eat a gluten diet and you're sensitive to gluten, you destroy the bowel. You see up here in the right-hand corner, you have all of the active, healthy, large villi of a normal intestine. When you eat the components of wheat, barley, and rye, gluten, what happens is you knock down that brush border. It becomes ineffective. It allows proteins all kinds of proteins to get through into the bloodstream. And you get autoimmune diseases. It's easy to follow the McDougall diet and follow a gluten-free diet. You just have to avoid wheat, barley, and rye. That's not hard. Potatoes, sweet potatoes, etc., make it really easy. So do beans, peas, and lentils. Eating an unhealthy diet in other ways besides the gluten component, besides celiac mechanisms, other components of the Western diet, and again, I would be getting into details that are unnecessary and probably not fully scientifically delineated if I was to go into these components. But we do know that a high-fat, low-fiber diet knocks down this brush barrier also. So just eating the American diet sets you up. You don't have to have this particular sensitivity of celiac disease, which only 1 in 100 or 1 in 256 people have, even though 40% of the population thinks they have a problem with gluten. I know that because they buy gluten-free products at the stores. Let's talk about some ancillary issues related to the animal proteins. If you're going to eat animal protein, you're going to eat microbes that threaten your health. Why? We're animals. And so things that infect animals can infect us easily because we're from the animal kingdom. And so animals pass diseases such as trichinosis and salmonella, mad cow, prions, various kinds of cancer-causing viruses. They pass it to other animals, and other animals being us. But you don't hear that. You know, when they talk about some kind of food poisoning such as the E. coli that occurred in Seattle about 25 years ago from the apples that children ate and killed them. They talk about the apples as being the problem. Or when they talked about the cantaloupe being infected with salmonella in Europe 5 years ago, the cantaloupe. And it takes about, and during this process, them talking about these various vegetable foods that we love and eat, people come to the conclusion there's nothing safe to eat. And then finally, after about a month or two, they'll tell the rest of the story. And that is, the reason that these microbes got into their food was because the cow walked through the field and pooped on your cantaloupes. Or the field worker pooped on your strawberries. Or in the process of killing and slaughtering the cow, they ruptured the intestines and the intestinal contents full of salmonella, staphylococci, and other bad guys end up spilling on the foods that you eat. I have to point out for you that diseases that affect plants are not a worry to us because our systems are so different. They come from the animal kingdom. Excuse me, they come from the plant kingdom. We come from the animal kingdom. The difference in these kingdoms is so great in terms of metabolism that you don't catch plant diseases. You don't have friends with Dutch elm disease or tobacco mosaic virus. None of the people you know have aphids. So when you hear about these infections due to eating these high animal protein foods, you know, they may keep you off guard for a few minutes thinking there's nothing safe to eat, but you got to realize this infection came from the animal kingdom, from other animals directly to you and your family. The other thing about animal foods is they're high on the food chain. So whatever you have in the environment in terms of chemical contamination is biomagnified. And as a result, these pesticides, herbicides, and other cancer-causing and brain-damaging chemicals, they get concentrated in the flesh and fat of the animal. Biomagnification causes bioaccumulation. So eating on the food chain, if you want to eat a low-pesticide diet, eat plant foods. And of course, then you want to take and eat organic as much as possible. Makes sense. More interesting changes that occur from eating this diet high on the food chain, a diet loaded with meat and dairy, et cetera, is the effect on our sex life. It's interesting that when people eat the Western diet, particularly in men, we find a dramatic change in their manliness, their manly abilities, their ability to procreate. We find that meat eaters have a decreased ejaculate volume. You know what I'm talking about, an ejaculate volume? It's decreased. Nothing to brag about. Low sperm count, shortened sperm life, poor sperm motility, genetic damage. Children that are born to mothers who eat the Western diet have smaller penises and smaller testicles, and you get hypospadia, which is a urethral deformity that is just terrible. It's where the urethra, instead of emptying at the end of the penis, empties at the base of the penis. And undescended testicles from the chemicals that are consumed by person and mother on the Western diet. We shouldn't be doing this. I think one of the strongest statements that we are vegetarians comes from our male anatomy. There are a couple of sacs that are under the bladder, just above the prostate. These are seminal vesicles. They collect sperm between ejaculations. These seminal vesicles are only present in vegetarian animals. Man is the only meat eater that eats that has seminal vesicles. The only meat eater that in all of the animal kingdom who has seminal vesicles who eats a meat diet. All the other animals that have seminal vesicles are the collection pouches for ejaculate. All these other animals are vegetarians. Do you think maybe we ought to be vegetarians? I would think so. How about soy foods? Let's take a minute on soy foods for a minute. Soy foods, well, there's a difference. There are traditional soy foods such as soy milk and tofu and miso and tempeh, which we use as condiments on our program. And then there are other fake foods such as candy bars and hot dogs and Boca burgers and various kinds of ice creams and cheese cakes that are not healthy, that you should be staying away from. So when the McDougall diet allows or even includes soy products, we're talking about traditional natural soy products that have been made in the kitchens of people for 5,000 years through simple processes such as grinding and filtering and fermentation. Not foods that are made in a manufacturing plant where they use machinery that's intended to make fiberboard and other construction materials that applies heat and pressure to turn something, to turn this conglomeration of chemicals made from vegetable components into things like that look like our old familiar foods like hot dogs and hamburgers. These things are very unhealthy. The traditional Asian diet, the one that that people often think of as a diet of soy, it's not really a diet of soy. It's a diet of rice and wheat noodles and rice noodles and with some vegetables. And there's a little meat or a little soy in their diet. However, that type of information, that type of truth that people who eat a higher soy protein diet, who like soy foods, like the Asians, have a lower incidence of disease, which is true, but not because of the soy products. It's because of the fact that they live on a starch-based diet, mostly rice in most cases. That's been translated into the idea that soy protein has become a miracle drug, which will keep you healthy and prevent progression of disease. It's not. These are chemical concoctions that do not promote good health. You may say, well, they're good for transition foods. After all, John, you're trying to save the planet. Won't we save the planet by going to these kinds of foods? Well, a little bit, but it's not right. You're never going to be able to manufacture enough fake foods to supply the population of the Earth. But we got enough potatoes, rice, and corn to feed everybody on this planet easily, 100-fold over. You often talk about soy protein having special properties, such as estrogen-like properties to prevent bone loss or heart attacks. And soy does have that kind of effect. It is potentially a cancer preventative substance, and it does it by decreasing the estrogen effect on a woman's body. The soy contains phytoestrogens that occupy the active sites in the body that are usually occupied by regular estrogens. And so in that way, it decreases the estrogen effect in the body. You decrease the number of days that a woman bleeds by adding soy to the diet. You decrease the time between menstrual periods on a soy-based diet. But there's concern that feeding all this estrogen to men might not be so good. I've even heard it brought up that that consuming a lot of soy foods could make a man impotent or change a man's interest in other ways. The ultimate in protein poisoning is seen among explorers, particularly those who traveled to the Arctic and Antarctic, and got into situations of food deprivation. And as a result, they only had some wild animals to eat, which were very low in fat and high in protein. And these explorers developed something known as rabbit starvation, because rabbit was often the food that all they had was to eat. And as a result, they got very sick, developed diarrhea, nausea, vomiting, and eventually died. Well, the protein content of this diet was about 30 to 40%, the diet that causes this rabbit starvation. Interesting for you to note is the paleo diet, which is focused on our ancestral eating patterns, is 35% protein and certainly able to set you up for protein starvation, protein or rabbit starvation or protein poisoning. So, to end our discussion, when you weigh everything and you weigh the fact that, and you understand the fact, which is from my first lecture, that it's impossible to design a protein deficient diet based upon natural foods. You can't do it against the known toxicity of these, of consuming protein in excess. You can make a decision. You can understand. And hopefully you'll never be threatened by your friends and relatives, well-meaning as they may be, when they come up to you and say, you're a vegetarian, you're a vegan, where do you get your protein? Well, you can spend a whole hour talking to them about why you don't focus on high-protein foods and why you actively pay attention to avoiding protein toxicity and protein poisoning. Thank you, AJ.
Wow, Dr. McDougall, that was amazing. Please take your slides off sharing so that I can see you. If you don't mind.
Yeah, why not?
Thanks. Dr. McDougall, that's mind-blowing that we only have the requirement for 3% of calories from protein. That is so low that people would think
Think about it for a minute, AJ. In the most rapid time of our growth, which is when we're an infant, our ideal food is breast milk. And breast milk is only 5% protein. So when you become an adult, you're not supposed to be growing anymore. So you don't have these excessive needs of 5% protein. Remember, the diet that we teach is about 8% protein. The American diet can be, 35, 40% protein. After your babyhood, after your initial growth spurts, what do you have protein for? Replace some of the skin cells that wear off, or the gut cells that wear off, and maybe grow some hair. What do you need protein for? So yeah, the requirement is about 3% of the calories is protein. It's impossible to design a protein deficient diet. But with an emphasis on that wrong direction, people are focusing on a nutrient component that is killing them and killing the animals, directly and indirectly by killing their habitat, their natural habitat, and killing the plant. So, AJ, we really got to get this protein myth straightened out. If we're going to move forward at switching everybody on this planet to a starch-based vegan diet. And we're going to do it.
Doesn't it drive
you? You've been here for a long time. And when I get something in my head, it's hard to let go. I have focused that we are going to be the missing component on this climate change picture. Everybody else is talking about fuel efficiency, production of energy from non-fossil fuel sources. That's all they're talking about. Well, that's great. It has to be done, but it's not enough. We are too far gone. The only way we're going to save the planet is to fix the people. And primarily what I'm talking about here in terms of fixing people is to put them on a healthy diet that requires so much less from planet Earth. And we'll allow planet. Remember, I started telling you a few minutes ago. I told you in the last lecture, some of the lectures that I've talked to you about, is that the healing capacity of the body is amazing. For example, life. There was 20 pack years. That means 2 packs a day for 7 years of cigarettes that I smoked. With all that poison that I inhaled in my body, can you believe it? 74 years old, I can still breathe. I may be slightly impaired, but I can still breathe. So my body's ability to to compensate, to heal. Well, I had to stop the poison, which I did on October 20th, 1972, at 7 o'clock in the morning. That was the last cigarette I had. Well, I see that with other people, with you folks who have rotten arteries and who are overweight and who are constipated and have arthritis, et cetera. Your body is trying to heal, but you keep the damage coming in terms of your fork and spoon. And so even though the body's always trying to heal, makes every effort, even its autoimmune reactions are an attempt to heal, misguided. The body is not strong enough to keep up with that pace of injury. Give it a break. And when you do, when you follow the kind of diet that many of you have learned from many sources, not just the McDougall people, but ideally the McDougall people, I have to say, I wouldn't recommend what I recommend as an ideal diet if I didn't believe it, because I certainly aren't winning a popularity contest by taking vegan cheesecake away from you.
Dr. McDougall,
give the planet a chance, AJ. You know, we got to stop the fossil fuels, yes, but we got to stop the production of an animal-based diet, which is so environmentally toxic. Remember we talked about, well, maybe not, we'll talk about it tomorrow, about how the conclusion is by the World Health Organization, or World Watch Institute, that over half the greenhouse gases are produced by the livestock industry. And the fact that the Lancet Commission came out and said that if we'd all go vegan, we'd reduce the production of greenhouse gases by 50% overnight. Anyway, if we give the planet a chance, it's always healing, just like the individual organisms it supports, like the people and the other animals, it's always healing. Health, longevity, you know, excellent function, sustenance, these are things that are built into the life function. We can't control them except by eliminating the damage that we're doing. Your body's never let you down. Your planet hasn't let you down either. So, you know, stand up, join the movement. You got nothing, I think, more important to do, because after all, the World Watch Institute told me in 2013 that we had 3 years left to fix things before they're unfixable. The Lancet Commission in 2019 said we have 8 to 12 years left to fix what's going on, or it'll become unfixable. You know, we may have passed the time, but I'm not going to stop trying. I'm a grandfather. I love this planet. I love all the animals and the flowers and the birds and the trees. And so I just think this is the most wonderful thing imaginable, to think that this little blue dot in the universe can exist called planet Earth. And I'm not going to let it go without a fight.
Dr. McDougall, there's a couple things, if you don't mind me commenting on, and possibly even take a few questions. But I first wanted to say, I love when you said you're not doing yourself a favor when you switch to vegetarian, you're just switching one type of animal protein for another. So that was very helpful. And one of the things you also said that it blew people's mind, that 600 days, the fat still remains.
Yeah, that was, yeah.
So how do we ever get rid of it then?
It takes 600 days to replace the body fat that you have. Say your body fat is populated by trans fats and omega-3 fats because you've been eating a whole bunch of flaxseed oil. Say you stop that, you correct that behavior and went on the kind of diet that I recommend. It would take almost 2 years to take and replace the unhealthy body fat surrounding your hips and abdomen and legs with healthy body fat. That's how long it takes, 600 days. After you change your diet.
That's almost 2 years.
Yeah, it's 2 years. Well, what do you expect? You spent 30 years getting it there.
Does it drive you crazy, Dr. McDougall? Well, at least when we used to go to restaurants, a lot of restaurants are like these kind of bowl restaurants where you kind of pick what you want and they assemble it. And then you get to the end and they go, well, you want some protein with that? And it's like—
Oh, yeah, right. it's universal in the belief that protein is the most essential, important ingredient in the diet. That's 180 degrees from the truth. You know, when you say protein, you should say poison. That's what you say. Poison. because in consumed in amounts and types like we do on the American diet, people are dying. I showed you the figures. You know, a third die of heart disease. Oh, 10% have diabetes, 50% are pre-diabetic. This poison is real.
Yeah. Someone named Brensway asked a question, if the vegan diet would help with cysts.
Well, it depends on the cause of the cyst. There are cysts that are caused by inflammation of, say, a duct that normally drained efficiently. For example, a duct in your ovaries or in your breasts, your milk ducts. What happens is they get plugged up due to inflammation, due to the Western diet, and the fluids back up, creating a fluid-filled cyst. And so, yeah, I mean, sometimes these cysts, they get so solid that they won't reverse, but many times they'll reverse. For example, on a healthy diet, when you have fibrocystic breast disease, people improve quite dramatically when they change their diet.
Right. Thank you.
Breasts change from lumpy breasts to soft, nice, warm, comforting. Don't get me in trouble.
You're so funny, Dr. McDougall. This was a wonderful lecture. Dr. Daryl Woodruff is watching, and he said it was just marvelous, and it will be available for replay. And of course, I'll give you a copy anytime you want to come on and spot your stuff.
I'd like to take a few months of giving both of these lectures. As I say, you're my test group. I've never given this lecture before. In fact, I just finished it this morning, but I spent the last month doing it, at least a month, maybe 2 months. And you're kind of my test audience. And once I get good at it, you know, once I get all the bugs out, I'd like to come back and give it to you again.
You'd be more than welcome. It just so happens I have an opening on March 22nd, which is, I know, your daughter Heather's birthday, but it's also mine. And I've been saving that date just in case you were available.
Well, we are, but I probably won't give you a lecture on protein. But I gave you a lecture on potatoes last month, didn't I?
Oh, that was great. That was great. You know what? I'd love a lecture on why we don't have to eat nuts to live.
Well, I'll do a lecture on high fat plant foods if you want. This is a big mistake that a lot of our, you know, our associates follow. It's hard for people to change. They're used to having this concentrated source of fat and calories. And when you give up the meat, you know, you find many people find nuts and seeds to be a good supplement as far as giving them this satisfaction they're used to. But you could change. It takes a couple of weeks to change. You change the amount of salt you eat from a high salt to a low salt diet in 2 weeks. You know, whereas animal foods you may find satisfying today, you know, once you make the switch in diet after 2, 4, 6 weeks, you'll find them very unsatisfying. You'll say to yourself, what am I going to eat? You know, what am I going to eat? The food that satisfies me.
Yeah. We so appreciate you, Dr. McDougall. Thank you so much. And I look forward to your summit tomorrow. I imagine it's going to go for a few hours.
It's going to go all day. We have two sessions, one in the morning, one in the afternoon, with different speakers. As I say, there are six speakers. I'm one of them. And I hope the message gets out. Again, it's the first time we've done this. I'm sure there are going to be some rough moments. But Heather and I are putting it on. And I think that's very appropriate that I have Heather, my daughter, involved in this because, you know, it's her children, my grandchildren. You know, it's Heather and other people in this particular age group that have most to lose, should be paying most. You should be in the street protesting what's going on to save your family. I don't understand this. You know, considering what people have been protesting lately, and considering what I used to protest when I was a youth, which was going to Vietnam.
I lost sound. That's weird. Charles, I lost sound. Charles! I can't hear you, Charles. I can't hear Dr. McDougall anymore. Oh my God. Charles, what's happening?